IVM.
I want to thank Intel for supporting our show. We're all loving working from home, but let's be honest, there are complications. For example, getting help from IT folks if your PC is down can be challenging because you can't just walk up to them anymore. Well, you'll be happy to hear that I have a solution for you. The Intel vPro platform. The platform comes packed with Intel Active Management technology that lets your IT teams remotely manage your systems and fix the problems without having to go to them. So it means more time getting your work done and less time spent on getting support. Visit intel.in/morewithvPro, that's VPRO, to discover how you can do more of what you want and less of what you don't. If you're listening on the IVM Podcast Android app, click the link that's visible to you now.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. I'm Prateek, and today I'm joined by Shambhavi and Sunila, and we're going to be talking about Patanjali and its coronal kit and all the associated implications of that. So before we dive in, let me just set a little bit of context on that. Last week, Patanjali announced Corona Kit, and I want to quote from their press release, which was basically what it said was that it's a clinically controlled trial-based medicine that was developed along with the National Institute of Medical Sciences in Jaipur. And it was accompanied with the claim that 69% of the patients it covered would recovered in 3 days and 100% in 7 days. Right. And since then, there's been a lot more that's happened. Initially, the government said it should discontinue advertising. This week, it's now come back and rebranded itself as an immunity booster of sorts. Right? So it's been a very interesting week or so with this. So, can you guys tell us, tell our listeners a little bit more what's happening here? What are the implications of something like this?
Yes. So to begin with, Patanjali launched these two Ayurvedic drugs for curing, as they said before, for curing coronavirus, which are called Coronil and Shwasari. So they conducted clinical trials in collaboration with the National Institute of Medical Sciences, which is based in Jaipur. It is a private institute, and they claim that they have conducted clinical trials in three cities, namely Delhi, Meerut, and Ahmedabad. According to the news reports, the Rajasthan government says that it has no idea of such clinical trials being conducted, and the state licensing unit of Uttarakhand, where the manufacturing unit of Patanjali is based, they said that when Patanjali applied for the Coronil kit manufacturing, they did not mention it was actually for coronavirus, and that's why the licensing unit gave them the permission to go ahead. But while announcing the drug, they marketed it as saying that it cured all the coronavirus patients that were involved in the study. So that's where the confusion started from.
Yeah, I think this this case study is really interesting because you can actually use it to look at the various aspects of a clinical trial and actually pinpoint on where things can go wrong and maybe figure out what governance strengthening we need to do to make sure that this doesn't happen again. Right. So there are several aspects which we can think of. So for example, when Patanjali came out and did this big launch, the Ayush Ministry immediately said that, hey, where are all of these details? We don't know. Please send us what medicines you have given, where the study was carried out, what clearances you have received. So for every clinical trial, you also have to register with the clinical trial registry, and you have to get clearances from institutional ethics committees as well as different scientific advisory bodies. So the CCRAS, which is the Central Council for Research in Ayurvedic Sciences, which is part of the Ayush Ministry, has set out clear-cut guidelines on how clinical trials for Ayurvedic medicines should happen. And so a number of compliances have to be figured out first. And basically, in response to the launch, the Ayush Ministry said, can we see all of this documentation. Patanjali came out and said that, hey, we have got all of this done, all the procedures have been followed, and we are replying to the Ayush Ministry with all the documentation that they have asked for. Now, when that documentation got submitted, we found there were more issues with the trial itself. So, if you think about a clinical trial, right, the idea is that you will have two groups of homogeneous participants. So, for example, if you are trialing an allopathic drug, you can't have a patient who has mild COVID symptoms and a patient who has severe COVID symptoms in the two groups. And then you try something on them, right? You'll have to have a similar age, same gender person in one group, and you can compare that with a second group, which will not, presumably not get the drug that you're trialing. So, and these procedures, similar procedures have been laid down for Ayurveda as well. Obviously, the way Ayurveda approaches curing a disease is very different from the way allopathy approaches it. Ayurveda is more holistic. There's dependence on diet, there's dependence on the prakriti of the person that you're testing. So the way you create the homogeneous groups also has to be a little different. We can't apply the same principles of allopathic clinical trials onto Ayurveda. So when they actually filed the documentation, we found that while in the press briefing, that's at 280 people, they had actually tried only 100. And then they had only looked at people who had mild to moderate symptoms, and that people who did not have any comorbidities. Anyone who had severe symptoms were given allopathic drugs. So they basically looked at a very small proportion of the trial patients that they were supposed to have looked at with mild symptoms and said that, hey, these got cured. So instead of actually setting that context, they just went and said, oh, we have trialed this in a clinical trial, and we are getting, well, the results that we want to show is that everyone that we wanted to get better got better. That's basically kind of what has happened. And there was a criminal case launched against them. People also figured that when they actually applied for the trial, it was for immunity boosting potential of the concoction that they are now selling at Coronel. And they did not mention that it was supposed that they were going to market it as a cure for corona. So the again, the principles of Ayurveda, and I have to give a disclaimer here that I have only read about Ayurveda over the past year. I am not a practitioner and do not have in-depth knowledge of the way Ayurveda works. But the way Ayurveda has been treated so far, we have always looked at it as a dietary supplement. Even in the governance system for looking at Ayurveda supplements, they looked at as dietary supplements. I don't think there's a single clinical trial going on in the country on severe patients being treated with Ayurveda. It's again mild, or it's just let's try and see if it can boost immunity and protect against the virus. So it has looked at more prophylactic measures than actually to treat the disease, right? In those terms, that's what Patanjali also tried to do and would have been acceptable in the Ayurveda practice. This whole coronal cure is something that has been an extremely exaggerated claim from them.
Also, the speed with which they launched this coronal and Shwasari was very surprising, because one of the investigations by the Quint said that the trial was registered on 20th May and the first patient was recruited on 29th May. So them announcing results on 23rd June was very surprising and very quick. Like, clinical trials are not expected to be completed within a month. So that was really suspicious as well.
Yeah, and again, I don't know about the rigor, about the approach that Ayurveda clinical trials have to be carried out on. Because it's a different system, they do not have to adhere to the same endpoints that allopathic clinical trial would have to adhere to, is what I guess. And I think one of the things that we have been doing wrong is trying to look at their clinical trials in the same context as looking at allopathic clinical trials. They're two different systems of approach which are looking at two extremely different things.
Yeah, so that was actually going to be my next question. Right? How will this affect the perception of Ayurveda in general? Because it seems to be quite a polarizing thing, right? There are some people who swear by it. There are others who completely ridicule it, right? Or have no faith in it whatsoever.
Yeah, I think my opinion about Ayurveda has always been that if people believe in it, then they have the constitutional right of belief, and the constitution bestows them that they are allowed to believe, right? We can't ridicule them for it, even if other people don't believe it. And they have the right to access it. I think as a policy analyst, my main concern is to make sure that people who dispense of Ayurvedic medications are dispensing stuff of high enough quality that it will not cause harm. And if anyone is claiming something that is not true, then that has to be stopped. And that for that, I think Ayush did try. I mean, initially, I think ever since COVID has come, Ayush has gone up and down. The ministry has gone up and down in their rules of a little. So they came out with an advisory very early on, which basically said that, hey, you can try a bunch of these things to try and prevent COVID. And obviously, none of those things had actually ever been proven to prevent COVID. Again, the way Ayurveda has worked is that there is this database of symptoms and what you can do, etc., right? Text which have a lot of documentation on what to give when. And so we had basically looked at the similar symptoms that COVID displays, what is in Ayurveda that can prevent those that kind of a condition. And then we'll try and see that if that prevents from COVID-19 as well. But the initial advisory kind of did not set that context either. It said, hey, you use these to prevent COVID-19. That caused a little bit of backlash. We also saw a number of people come and claim that, hey, we have created this Ayurvedic drug which was going to now cure COVID-19. And Ayush actually put out an advisory saying that there will be consequences if you claim an Ayurvedic concoction to have more impacts than it actually does, right? Unless it is tested. So they are trying to prevent that kind of backlash on general Ayurveda things. And this incident does not help that cause at all. But having said that, I don't think it is fair that we label the entire field of Ayurvedic research based on this single incident. I mean, we have seen similar incidents with allopathy as well. We recently saw with the trials of HCQ, which had to be retracted because the data wasn't solid enough. But we don't see people saying that, hey, all allopathy should be banned. This is a pseudoscience, right? There is some benefit to trialing Ayurveda, and I think definitely given the current situation, applying scientific rigor to it is necessary. I don't think we should just say that, hey, this doesn't work and we should shut down everything. I don't think that's in our national interest either.
Yeah, it interesting that you mentioned Ayush's response to it also, because I was actually surprised by how quickly they responded to it. And the other thing, so something that Rohan and me were, so when we were looking at this, right, we were looking at it largely from an information perspective in terms of how this information is flowing through, right? Mm. And we went and studied how the platforms are responding to this compared to what they had claimed they will do, right? And we found that whether it, you know, none of them from Google, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, TikTok, ShareChat, all of these that we looked at, Twitter, all of them announced a varying set of measures that they will take. But none of them actually flagged any content related to Corona at the time, saying that, okay, this is potentially misleading content or anything, right? Or you know, even if it's not misleading, at least to say that it's unverified, right? There was nothing of the sort. So it was quite interesting. And then you couple that with the sort of TV coverage that it got as well, right? Yeah. On the day that it launched, I think a lot of people probably walked away that day with the assumption that, hey, maybe this can actually cure it, right? It's interesting to look at that from what it does to your information ecosystems also, because what would have happened is that, you know, these existing camps would have just probably gotten strengthened, right? Those, like you were pointing out, that people who don't believe in it, people who ridicule it would have, were doing that, right? They were making fun of the whole situation.
Yeah, I found it really interesting because obviously subsequent to all of this, also the Jaipur Private Medical College came out and said that there were no clinical trials. Yet none of this has actually deterred the fact that Patanjali is still going to sell Coronil, right? It's going to sell Coronil as an immunity boosting drug, not as a cure for Corona. But you know, Pratik, what I found very interesting about the entire information thing here is that a lot of people that I've spoken to are like, ha, theek hai, maybe it's not going to cure Corona. It's okay, but at least we know about it and they say it's immunity boosting. And if you look at the actual medical composition of it, it's not a novel thing. Okay, it is something that has been known in Ayurveda for a long time, and a lot of other concoctions also have a similar composition. Just that the PR activity on this has been amazing, and because of the controversy, everybody now knows about this. And now people are like, huh, anyway, if it doesn't have any harm and it might improve my immunity, why not? Even if you're in one of those swing zones, right, where you're like, hey, I don't know if this will work or not, it is still that, okay, but I guess they're saying that it is not harmful and it might have some benefits, so why not?
I think one should not miss out on how when Patanjali launched this drug, they claim to have like 100% efficiency of the drug for curing coronavirus patients. But as soon as the Ministry of Ayush asked them for reports or anything, they took a U-turn and suddenly said, oh, we never claimed that it can cure coronavirus. We just said that it was able to treat coronavirus patients. So I don't know what exactly that means, but yeah.
Yeah, and the other part, I think, was recently a statement that came out, right, from ANI quoted their CEO, which basically said that we didn't say that the medicine will cure or control coronavirus. We said that we had made medicines and used them in clinical control trials, which cured corona patients.
Yeah.
There is no confusion in it. I still haven't figured out what that statement is.
Yeah. It is only confusion.
No, but going back to your point about, it's harmless. And this is something that I'm personally very conflicted on because, you know, at the one level in this context, yes, it is probably harmless, right? But then
we assume that the clinical trials have been done and showed that.
Correct, yeah. Right? There's multiple levels of it, right? That you're taking these things at, you're taking claims like this at face value, right? There's also this larger this thing of, you know, like I said, you're taking claims at face value and how it's affecting your whole information ecosystem. I'm sorry, I'm going to keep harping on that because. Yeah, that's something that I look at very closely, right? And there's been this trend of now looking at information not from the perspective of whether it's only true or false, and whether it's meant to cause harm or not. That whole disinformation, misinformation. It's also what effects that does it have, right? Into your overall ecosystem. And I think that's where this part is a little interesting because it can, right? When you start accepting things at face value, it also has long term consequences for your information ecosystem. While in an isolated context, yes, it's harmless. But how is it affecting our general belief in how rigorous clinical trials should be, what kind of scrutiny we should put these sort of organizations under, right? That is getting impacted or that is getting lost somewhere.
Yeah, and how do we hold them accountable, right? I mean, this might have just been a marketing gimmick for them, right? Saying that, hey, we've launched something that we know is 100% going to cure corona might be nothing more than a marketing gimmick, considering that they might not have enough data. Or might have not done rigorous enough trials to say that. But it has caught everybody's attention. Then they could just do a U-turn. And then they could say, hey, no, actually our clinical trials were limited. But we signed it up for immunity boosting thing. And that's what we're going to say. That we're not going to say that it's a corona cure anymore. Okay, that's okay. And to let them get away with that, right? To let them get away with exaggerating, with lying, right? That they've done something that they've not. And there has been absolutely no punishment for that yet. I think that is the problem. So we know that there has been disinformation circulating, and we know the power of disinformation now, and the fact that these guys could just use it for their own benefit is ridiculous. I mean, there's a science part of it that we need to fix, but the more powerful we let this use of disinformation as an actual PR tool get, the more problematic it is going to be in the future.
Do we not have any legislation or any provision under the Drugs and Magic Remedies Act for that, like for to hold them accountable?
Okay, a criminal case has been made against them. But by the time that criminal case actually reaches to some kind of end, and we don't even know what end it will be, the company would have made a lot of money, right, selling Coronal. So
because they will be selling it anyway as immunity boost.
Yeah, they've anyway rebranded this now, right? So and it's probably in the name. I had looked into some other related things, and I found that this is not the first time something like this has happened. Back in October 2019, they had released a drug called Denguinil, which is supposed to go straight for the dengue disease, as they claimed, and it was supposed to be a 10-day course. And this is a quote from an article in the Mint, which says that it's a 10-day course, and if it doesn't work, take it for 20 days, right? And it goes back to what you were saying, Shambhavi, that it seemed that you can make a claim and then just get away with it. There seemed to be no holding anyone to account.
No, it's a business story more than actual science story, right? It's how you sell your product, not the scientific grounding of it. And I don't think that we should encourage this in any way.
That's true.
Okay. So then I guess the other question is there something that can be done other than, our regular thing of, yes, people should be more, we should make society more resilient to this sort of information. Are there any other sort of measures or policy solutions you guys can think of that might be helpful?
So I think one of the things that I think we are struggling to is there seems to be a treatment of different verticals of medicine as different religions. I was talking to a friend of mine who's an allopathic doctor, and he was telling me that he was saying about how allopathy, Ayurveda, and the other traditional forms of medicine are all treated as different religions. And then if you are an allopathic doctor, you have this great aversion for Ayurveda. That's the way you've been brought up. And that I think is the first thing that needs to kind of go. We need more integration of the various forms of medicines. And the second part is the scientific rigor that we need to bring to traditional practices, right? I think that has been a constant struggle, is because we have been trying to superimpose a lot of the Western clinical trials concept onto traditional medicine, which is way different, right? So, for example, with Ayurveda, your diet is very important. The time you get up is very important. That you follow certain exercises can also supplement the impact that Ayurvedic medicines can have on you, which is a more holistic form of a trial than just saying that, hey, you take this drug at this time and you come back after 10 days, right? So we have not yet been able to create that kind of a systematic plan for how we can scientifically test Ayurvedic medicines. The ICMR actually has a plan. They came up with a plan for 2030, what grand vision for what they thought the ICMR would be like. And that had a plan to scientifically test Ayurveda. So if that actually comes to fore, then I think we can give a lot of legitimacy, build a lot of confidence amongst doctors and patients for Ayurvedic medicines as well. So those two things, I think, are going to be key in making sure that at least the quality of the medicines that we put out are good. And then obviously the third part would be to do something about these exaggerated claims. I mean, those really, really need to stop.
Yes, so I agree with what Shambhavi said. So first of all, as she said, that allopathic doctors have a strong aversion towards Ayurveda. So I think we need to look at other Asian countries as well, like how much importance they place on traditional medicine in countries like Taiwan and Korea. Like they are on equal level with the allopathic medicine. It is that we need to change the perspective and the way we look at it, and to give it more legitimacy, I think we need more strong legislation and laws so that incidences like these don't happen. And we don't look at it as something that is, voodoo, or it is just some plans that we don't know if they will cure diseases or not. So it will give it more legitimacy when they are backed by strong laws, I think.
All right. Okay. Yeah. So if I were to sum up, basically saying have a more systematic way of testing them, right? Which will then get into larger society of looking at these medicines, not with the same level of skepticism that we have today, but as maybe an alternate course of medication.
Let us be objective about it, right? There is a documentation about this. let's see if it works or not. But let's not, even the idea to test it should not be that, hey, it has to work the same way as a allopathic drug does. It has to give the same endpoints as an allopathic drug does. No, it's a different form of medicine. Let's try and figure out that if we were to discover this kind of science now, how would we have tested it? And I don't think we would have come up with the same rules that we use for allopathy, right? And again, I think the most important point here is that I think about 25% of allopathic drugs have been derived from some form of plants or other natural sources. So they are in a different way, like an Ayurvedic concoction. It just basically, let's not try and get prejudiced when we look at Ayurveda. If the science says it works, the science says it works. If the science says it doesn't work, it doesn't work. Let's not sit in either camps, right? It's just try and figure a way to get things to work.
Yeah, I like what you said about looking at it as if it was new, something new that we discovered now, right? How would we treat it in that sense? How would we approach it in that sense? I think that was quite interesting.
Yeah. If it doedn't work, we should not be like wedded to the idea that, hey, this is an age old science that has come from India, so we have to follow it. No, if it doesn't work, it doesn't work.
All right. Okay. So on that note, thank you, Shambhavi. Thank you, Sunila, for joining us.
Thanks, Pratik.
Thank you.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM podcast app, ivmpodcast.com. or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. I'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and Intel. So, been a really exciting week on the network this week. We've had some really cool stuff. My old friend Vivek Lath was on Storytellers and Storysellers. Definitely do check that out. On Cyrus Said, we had Ashwin Sanghi on Thursday's episode. And Cyrus and myself did a cock and bull, just the two of us. That was fun as well on Monday. Do check that out. Masaba was on Advertising is Dead, which was another really, really strong episode from Varun. And on the sports front, both Edges and Sledges, Football had some really fun episodes. That's the Football Twaddle. Do check those out as well. And if you haven't been paying attention and you haven't been listening to Smile India in these times, I don't know why you aren't. It's the most uplifting show that you could listen to. It's a short, bite-sized piece of really positive things that happen in India. Do definitely check that out. And with that, we hope to see you again next week.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere. Robo-advisory, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money, now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have.